This is the Bears Barroom Radio Network. Parental discretion is advised.
There are so many streaming TV series.
So many channels.
I have a stream.
I just don't know which one to watch.
Is this show worth our time?
I have a stream.
I'm three seasons behind already. Is it even worth catching up?
I have a stream.
What's the series about? Well, my wife liked it too.
I have a stream.
What channel is it on? And who's in it?
I have a stream.
I want to watch something new, something original.
I have a stream.
I want to watch something that's action-packed.
I have a stream.
What's happening, barflies? Welcome to Bears Barroom Radio Network and the I Have a Stream podcast. This is John Santucci. Call me Tooch. With me, as always, is my sidekick, my partner in crime, Joey Two Scoops, Joe Mandel.
Tooch, what's going on, brother?
Oh, I'm excited to talk Game of Thrones episode 5, The Bells, and we got a great memory stream tonight. A couple surprise guests, Joe. And
yeah, we do.
We're gonna have to call in the bartender so I can order my drink.
We should do that. Let's cue up his song. That's queuing up the Mastodon, everybody, and you know what that means. We're queuing in our bartender. Aaron Michalski's in the house. Aaron, how you doing, brother?
Not too bad, gentlemen. It's good to be back. How are you guys?
Aaron, it's good to have you back. I'm going to have my usual bourbon on the rocks.
All right. Sounds good. I can get that for you. What's everybody else?
Well, you know, Two Scoops always goes the same way. I've got my very special beer glass for tonight. It's a Duff beer glass, Tooch. So I'm going to go ahead and take a Duff beer. So
Duff here's... man.
Oh, yeah. Duff man.
Nice. How about Aaron, pour yourself something? Because all those said drinks are on the house again.
All right. Sounds good. I went with the Guinness draft last time. We're going to go with the Leinenkugel Summer Shandy this time.
Ooh. Very. That sounds nice.
Yeah, very friend. Must be hot. Must be hot in Carter Lake.
It's a little, yeah, but I'm also a bald ginger, so it's always hot if it's past 70 degrees.
Wow. Wow, I like it.
Nice.
Going unexpected turns, man. I like that.
Gotta keep it interesting here in the barroom.
Well, Joe, let's do a little what are you watching and how's it going for you? And then we'll start with Joe. Tell us what's new. What are you watching?
Well, I'm not gonna lie, Tooch. I've been so busy watching Barry. I was talking about it from last week.
Yeah,
that I'm still watching Barry. I'm still absolutely loving that. Good. And then in between that, I'll go ahead and admit it. I'm still binging the hell out of Pawn Stars. So between those two shows, that's pretty much all my time, my friend. And of course, we got Game of Thrones, but nothing new on my end.
Nice. And Aaron, what are you watching, and how's it going for you?
You know, I actually started a, for people that don't mind subtitles, you ever heard of Kingdom on Netflix? It's kind of zombies are so overplayed nowadays anyhow, but it's like zombies in feudal Japan.
Yeah, so, that was awesome. Yeah. It's Korea.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yep,
yeah. Yeah, that was excellent. Man, I really enjoyed that one. That's on Netflix.
Yep.
Right? Netflix that's great. One season, it goes by real quick, man. I totally forgot about it. That was really good, man.
I'm watching it a second time, but that ending where it hits you with that, oh my God, everything I thought I knew was not at all what it actually is or what they thought they knew about the phenomenon. Absolutely.
That's got me hooked. Yeah, can't wait for second season on that one, Joe. That's a really good one to watch. There's the character of the prince who's trying to find out information about his father, who may or may not have disappeared. And an outbreak in the rural area that he goes to investigate with his bodyguard. Yeah, that's good, man. And there's a few other characters, including a mystery, possibly former soldier, and a woman who was working in a hospital in that rural village. But yeah, it's called The Kingdom. Man, Aaron, glad you're enjoying that one. My wife and I burned through that one. That was excellent. So for me, I just I started Big Little Lies, episode one, and it's okay so far. It's the David E. Kelly show who brought us L.A. Law. And then season two for Big Little Lies starts June 7th, I think. So, my sultry neighbor, who may or may not drop by, she's been going to a lot of baseball games. Last week she went to the Cubs game. Had a little too much fun in the sun and did not make it last week, Joe. But I left an open invitation for her to drop by the bar room here, grab a drink, and talk Game of Thrones episode five with Bells with us. Tonight she's at another baseball game over here across the street from us, so she may or may not drop by, but we have a great memory stream coming up and a surprise guest or two, so barflies, stay tuned. For me, I also watched, Joe, extremely wicked, shockingly evil, and vile, which you and I are going to talk.
Yeah, I saw that too.
In-depth review of that movie with the barkeeper coming up in a couple weeks. Man, that was really good. Really good. I don't want to spoil too much. We'll talk about that later. Joe, what do you say we enter the memory stream and give the folks a good taste of a very special show?
Indeedly do, neighborino.
All right. Well, this show is nearly 30 years old, Joe. It debuted December 17th, 1989. And it is nearly 700 episodes in. 662 episodes have been broadcast. It's the longest running American sitcom, the longest running American scripted primetime television series in terms of seasons and in numbers of episodes. And when we play the clip, you know exactly what TV show we're talking about.
Now listen, boy, we have an understanding, and you'd better keep your end of it. I don't think I'd be any kind of a father if you got D's and I let you go to Camp Krusty.
But, Dad...
Son, if you really want something in this life, you have to work for it. Now, quiet, they're about to announce the lottery numbers.
17.
Don't!
32.
Don't!
5.
Don't!
8.
Woohoo!
47.
No!
Most having, most speaking.
Yeah, I'm looking for a friend. Last name Keybum. First name Lee.
Hang on, I'll check. Hey, guys, do I got a Lee Keybum? Come on, look at the stools. Is there a Lee Keybum? Somebody check the rear. I know I got a Lee Keybum.
Then you probably shouldn't be handling food.
Let me introduce you to the gang. That's Buzz. That's Honey. And you see that queen over there? Her name is Smithers. No one will want to kiss me after these, eh, Smithers?
Well, it's their loss, sir.
Yes. Smithers, there's a rocket in my pocket.
You don't have to tell me, sir. People like dogs, Mr. Burns.
Nonsense! Dogs are idiots! Think about it, Smithers. If I came into your house and started sniffing at your crotch and slobbering all over your face, what would you say?
If you did it, sir.
Let me get this straight. You took all the money you made franchising your name and bet it against the Harlem Globetrotters?
I thought the generals were due! He's spinning the ball on his finger! Just take it! Take the ball! That game was fixed.
Do they have crusty, partially gelatinated, non-dairy gum-based beverages?
Mm-hmm. They call them shakes.
Shakes.
I don't know what you're getting.
Well, I know what I'm getting. Some donuts. Help me out of the booth, boys.
You lied to me. Release the hounds.
No matter what you tell your child to do, it will always do the opposite. Huh? Don't you get it? You gotta use reverse psychology. That sounds too complicated. Okay, don't use reverse psychology. All right, I will.
Remember, 'tis better to remain silent and be thoughtful than to open your mouth and remove all doubt.
What does that mean? You better say something or they'll think you're stupid. Takes one to know one. Swish. All right, brain. You don't like me and I don't like you. But let's just do this and I can get back to killing you with beer. It's a deal.
Woohoo!
Oh, wow. What a great clip. So many great moments, man. It's 30 years of moments, Joe. Simpsons was recently... Sorry, I don't want to steal your news and two scoops. The Simpsons was recently renewed for a 31st and a 32nd season, the latter of which will feature its 700th episode. 700.
Wow.
Simpsons has been on more than half of my entire life. So it's
been I have to say to that? Holy smokes.
What year did it air?
So, aired in December 17th, 1989. So,
Just barely a year older than
him. Yeah. I was 21. So, I remember back then, and before that, I believe it was on the Tracy Ullman show, which was also on Fox. And
Needly-do, Neighborino.
Yep, they just were short little clips, and Fox was really smart, and they turned it into a full-time sitcom and never looked back. Simpsons has won 31 Emmy Awards, Aaron.
Wow.
Joe, they average one a year. Every single cast member who does voices has won an Emmy. There's so many moments, so many great characters. It's look at American life is like no other.
True that.
Do you have any favorite Simpsons memory of when you first encountered the show, maybe, Joe?
Well, man, I'm super into the early years of The Simpsons when Conan O'Brien was writing on the show. Really, really loved the monorail episode. During the first or second, maybe the third season, there's an episode where Bart becomes like a mini golf wizard and he's like entering this mini golf tournament against Todd Flanders. And it's just one of my favorite episodes. It's just so fun and so goofy, and it's got the Simpsons signature charm. So I just remember back to that, and when I was a kid, every night at 10 o'clock they'd have the reruns. They'd have that at 10 o'clock, and then they'd have Seinfeld on afterwards. And for me, that's just like the staple of my childhood right there.
Yep, it's a Sunday night staple. Aaron, how about your favorite Simpsons memory or character, maybe that you identify with? What do you say?
You know, for me, it's Homer. Everything's about Homer in that show, especially any time he would scream. There's a part that I can't remember. It's the episode where Homer became an artist, if you remember that one. And Bart says something about, how's the sculpture going? And Bart says, I think he's almost done. And then he looks in the back, and Homer has this great, big, high-pitched scream. And then he jams an umbrella into this concrete thing, and it blows up on him. But I think Homer, everything's about Homer for me in that show.
Right. It was a great, The Simpsons movie, of course, excellent movie. Marge also was an artist and painted Mr. Burns in the nude. Who could forget that?
Oh, my God, I forgot.
I'd like to.
Right. So, Joe, I actually arranged for us to have a Simpsons cast member call in the show.
What?
Yes. Aaron, are you ready? We got Krusty the Klown on the line tonight. Krusty!
Yes? I can't believe my career has sunk to the point where I'm on some stupid podcast. What do you want to know?
We have a chat room. We'll take questions too.
look, let's just get this through. I got things to do.
We first want to offer our condolences on the passing of your half-brother, Luke Perry. Very sorry.
My stupid half-brother, rest in peace.
And your daughter, Sophie, how's Sophie doing? I know she found you by Googling pathetic and clown, and your name came up.
Yeah, that's like the first 10,000 results you get on Google, so I'm pretty pathetic. Also, sell out. So if you're going to pay me, you know.
Oh, Aldo will pay you in booze at Bear's Bar. Joe, do you have a question for our honored guest?
Are you going to offer me a drink or what?
Yes. How about a drink, Aaron, for Krusty?
Krusty, what do you have, sir?
I will have a Mr. Teeny Martini.
Right, coming right
gin,
up.
Gin, vermouth, and it should taste like a monkey's fingers have been soaking in it.
I'll do my best to get that in the right
direction. Oh.
It sounds delicious.
It's not.
Hammered. Yeah, I'm sure it does.
Forget these pathetic podcasts I have to do just to supplement my bubblegum budget.
Oh, yeah, I love bubblegum.
And now helium's going away. That's bad for the
clown business.
How about that?
Hey, we've got a question in the chat room for you, Krusty. Little Nikki in the chat room would like to know, why haven't they come out with another Simpsons movie?
Well, I don't think they have enough money. You know, they need room for all those other fine Fox network programming that they do. And they just can't put the money together.
they spent it all on Gabbo, I think.
Yeah, that son of a bitch.
Aaron, do you have any questions for Krusty?
Yeah, I can't remember what episode it was, but I remember that you went on a bender and Lisa.
Well, you should be a lot more specific.
Well, okay. Well, this one specifically asked, have you been drinking gasoline? And you said, yes, I've been drinking gasoline, mother. Were you actually drinking gasoline?
No, it was more like Sterno, you know, like canned heat, you know.
Okay.
It's just, it'll make you throw up, but you'll wake up missing a shoe, a very big shoe.
In the as long as you're not missing your wallet.
You're right, no.
Is Krusty Burger still open?
What?
Is a Krusty Burger restaurant still
open? Oh, yeah. We cram enough food down America's gullets day after day, month after month, year after year, to keep the diabetes market in healthy returns for all our investors, including Krusty Co. and all his subsidiaries.
My favorite was the meat-flavored sandwich at Krusty Burger. The clogger is also pretty good, but...
Yeah.
They never got around to... they never got around to producing the whatchamacarcus. But...
No. The meat's really hard to wrangle. A lot of legs.
All right. How about... how many sideshow... companions did you have? I lost track.
They're all just a big blur, taking money away from me, where the spotlight should be.
The Krusty. Yeah. You've been married 15 times. Can you tell us how come you're so unlucky in love?
I think every marriage that I've had has been wonderful. My lawyer, of course, told me to say that, lest I have to pay any more alimony. Definition of my character.
All right.
Oh, that rotten little bastard. He's been banned from the set of Krusty Show. Still gets in, though.
Are Itchy and Scratchy still alive, Krusty?
Oh, they'll live on in perpetuity like that Simpsons show that they're going to force us to a 31st and 32nd and 33rd and how many years they want to do this thing. God.
Well, I hope it keeps going. It's one of my favorite shows, Krusty.
I do too. I love everyone there. Except Gabbo.
Do you guys have any last questions, Joe, before we move into the news with two scoops or less? And Aaron, any questions first, Joe?
Well, Krusty, I got to ask, you watching Game of Thrones, and what did you think of last week?
I can't follow that show. I mean, other than the nudity, that's pretty good. But and then with dragon fire, I mean, what? Come on.
Aaron, any last questions for Krusty?
You know, I guess what's been your favorite nudity on the show? How about that one?
The one where you see boobs and butts and not so much the men.
Nope, agreed. I'm with you there.
Nice. Well, I hope Simpsons keeps going. I love the show. We're all big fans here, Krusty. I want to thank you for joining us on I Have a Stream.
Hey, and this hasn't been not that terrible. You boys are all right.
Thanks, Krusty.
Thanks again, no Krusty. Hopefully you can come back.
Well, you know where to send the checks.
All right, that was Krusty the Klown. Of course, Joe, can we bring in our next guest?
Yes, sir.
Welcome him barroom style.
Yeah.
This guy here is Bears Barroom's voice impersonator. He's a man of many talents. He'll win you over with his wit and his Irish charm. If he likes you, he may even sculpt an alien head for you. Please welcome Brian Shanahan.
We don't get fooled again.
Hey! What was that crazy clown?
Welcome to Bears Barroom, Brian.
Hey, John. Hey, Joe. Hey, Aaron.
Hey, hey.
Can we get you a drink, Brian?
Yeah, sure. I'll have a screaming Dothraki.
Right on. Coming right up.
Oh, yeah. That sounds good. Mm. It'll make you charge for, I don't know, reason, right into a horde of undead and get wiped out. But then and then the majority are back for the next episode somehow.
Somehow. Magically.
All right, Joe, how about we do a little news in two scoops or less before we head up into Game of Thrones territory?
Let's do it. Here's the news from me.
What? You look like Mary Poppins. Is he cool? Hell yeah, he's cool.
I'm Mary Poppins, y'all!
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained? Here.
It's entertainment news in two scoops or less.
Holy smokes!
That's right, everybody. This is the entertainment news in two scoops or less. So big news today in the streaming world. Disney has gained full control of Hulu after a large deal with the Comcast Corporation. Comcast requires Disney to buy one-third of a stake in the streaming video service. This could open the door for edgy Marvel shows like Daredevil and Luke Cage to return. So with Disney running the show at Hulu, there could be quite a bunch of opportunities for some kind of edgy shows out there. So Moon Knight, like Aaron said, and a boatload of other shows could be returning, and R-rated shows at that. So that's pretty exciting. And going into my last bit of streaming news here, Netflix will be losing The Office, Friends, and other NBC shows in 2024. So that means you guys only have 5 years to finish binging all of those NBC shows. So you better get rolling on that. And that, my friends, is the news in two scoops or less.
Oh, man. Big news, Joe. Wow. I guess everybody better subscribe to Hulu before the price goes up. But
yeah, no doubt.
Yeah, it's great. It's great news. I mean, Hulu also has some great shows. Don't know if you guys watch Rick and Morty. Man, yeah, one of my favorite cartoons. Yeah. So funny. That's on Hulu. I binge watched all four seasons of that, man. I haven't laughed so hard. I haven't laughed that hard in a long time, but man, I love Rick. Man, Rick cracks me up. But I highly recommended Rick and Morty. If you're a Simpsons fan or Futurama fan or Family Guy fan, Rick and Morty's right up, almost in the same area, same sweet spot. So Joe, before we head into Game of Thrones talk, we have a word from our sponsor.
We sure do.
Citizens of the Seven Kingdoms, don't have Lannister's Lament. Protect your loved ones from yet another demented Targaryen. Protect your family with flameproof bunkers with a 10-minute wildfire rating. ADT Fire Protection. Anti-Daenerys Targaryen Systems. Thanks for listening.
That, of course, is Bear Lissimo. That's Bear Lissimo, if anybody's wondering. Thanks.
Nice.
All right. So, Game of Thrones episode 5, The Bells. Let's get into it.
Yeah, let's do it.
That was The Crazy World of Arthur Brown with Fire, Def Leppard, Rock of Ages from Pyromania,
and yeah,
Taylor Swift, White Horse. So pretty much.
Shame on you, John.
That gives us episode 5, Joe. So
you salty dog.
Well, there was a lot of Pyromania. It was the first thing I thought of. That was the first song I thought of, man. After this episode, but I kind of want to start with the death count. I think that's probably this was the episode where we lost the most characters, so let's just run through them. I think it's a good place to start. So the first character we lost was the spider, Lord Varys.
Yes.
I didn't have him in my death pool. One of my favorite characters. I love Condoleth Hill's portrayal. In the beginning, don't know if you guys noticed, but Varys was writing a bunch of letters. Kind of looked like he was writing one letter for a long time. It was actually multiple letters. And I want to get your guys' opinion on what you thought he was writing in those letters. Could anybody see? Let's start with Brian. Yes. What do you think Varys was writing?
Well, when I first watched that episode, it looked like he was writing about Jon Snow's true parentage. And I don't know, You know, I mean, it said something about Rhaegar Targaryen, and I think I saw Lyanna Stark. It was kind of tough to make out, but I'm sure if you could freeze frame it, and you might be able to pick out. I'm just curious if he was going to send it to somebody like that. Was it where the series started? Was it Illyrio Mopatis, who had the wedding for Khal Drogo?
Sure.
You know, like maybe like influence over there. You know, like
he arranged the marriage of.
Yeah. I mean, who is he writing to?
Don't know yet. That's a great question for next week.
Maybe. Yeah.
We'll find out, but it's probably my guess is he's rallying support for John. So Joe, what do you think Varys is writing? Are you kind of in agreement with that?
Yeah, I would say he's spreading the word because, you know, he's a smart guy. He knows of his demise, and I you got the people in Dorne that, you know, that could be some folks that he's reaching out to. Parts of, you know, all the Seven Kingdoms. He wants,
yep.
You know, Yara Greyjoy is out there.
Sure.
Lots of other people that will come rally to Jon Snow's aid because Varys can sense things and he knows that Dany's, no pun intended, going mad. So...
Right.
And yeah. there's one other point I wanted to bring up quickly about this is when they're coming to get him... To bring him to burn him alive, he takes off all his jewelry.
Yeah.
So curious. I'm gonna throw it back at you for a second, Tooch.
Man, I thought about
why?
That.
Why?
I'm not sure why. Maybe because he knew he was gonna get burned alive, since that was what Daenerys promised him. If you ever betray me, I will burn you alive. Aaron, I also want to ask you. Here's the thing. We knew Varys. This plot was brewing with Varys. Now Varys is on Dragonstone with no way off of Dragonstone. So nope. if he's gonna foment some kind of overturn of Dany, some rebellion from Dragonstone, it's not the best place, unless he was gonna poison her. Now, not sure if you noticed his little conversation with one of his little birds, who was the same girl he was hugging in the crypts in episode three. And the little girl informed him that
they're following
Daenerys her. Was eating nothing. But what do you think? Was Varys' plan with the little bird to poison Daenerys?
I mean, that's a good theory. I didn't even consider that, honestly. I kind of just thought maybe she was stressed out because she saw how much everybody liked Jon, you know, at the Battle of Abruzzo around him, and she basically doesn't have the right thing. I mean, that could be... I mean, who knows? Maybe he did poison her. Maybe that's why she went nuts at the end of the episode.
He did tell the little girl, well, we'll keep trying. And the biggest... the hardest sacrifices... deserve the biggest rewards.
Biggest rewards. Nope, I definitely remember that. So, absolutely, yeah. I mean, who knows? Maybe he did, and maybe that's why she turned at the end.
That's very possible. And we'll talk about Dany's turn, because that's one of the most controversial parts of this episode. And, of course, Varys' warning was that he didn't think he was wrong about Daenerys, and he didn't think he was going to be dying for nothing. So it's likely he got something off his words, his letters out. I'm going to say that's probably going to come to play in the next episode, our final episode. And Game of Thrones will come to an end next week. The thing about Varys is that he was always about the realm. He had the sense... that Jon Snow would make the better ruler, you know, but going out and talking to Jon about it where everyone could see him probably wasn't the best plan. But, you know, such as it is, we lost Varys. I know the actor was kind of disappointed with, you know, that aspect of the loss of his character. In fact, Joe and I talked offline about this today about... I sent him a clip of 3 minutes of the cast... expressing their disappointment with the last season. So, yes. Now let's talk about the next character that we lose, and that is Euron Greyjoy, who in the books, I liked Euron in the books a lot better than I liked Euron on the TV show. But I'm going to ask Joe, how did How did Euron wash up in the exact place where Jaime was paddling in for him into King's Landing?
I will tell you exactly how, and that's by lazy storytelling, John.
Right, exactly.
But, you know, it is what it is. I guarantee you that doesn't happen when George R. R. Martin puts out his final book, if he ever survives to do that. But, that whole fight between him and Jaime was stupid. I mean, it doesn't make any sense why Euron would want to kill him anyway. Like, I guess he could maybe see him as a little bit of a threat, but, like, I just don't get it. It doesn't make sense to me. I didn't believe it.
Yeah.
And it just seemed... I mean, Euron's an idiot character anyway, but he's felt extra moronic this week, so...
Yeah.
It just... And he's like, oh, I'm the man who killed Jaime Lannister. It's like, well, not really.
Well, we don't know if... let me pause you there for a second, because we don't know if they're dead. I mean, how's anybody confirm whether Jaime and Cersei are dead? We'll talk about their death, because I thought it was kind of a jip. But, we don't know how they're... Yeah, we don't know how anybody's going to find out whether or not they're dead. Do you think they're going to... They are dead. Do you think they're dead, Aaron?
You know, I'm going to call that the Walking Dead rule, because in the Walking Dead...
Glenn under the dumpster. It's the Glenn dumpster rule.
Yeah, exactly. If you don't see them actually die, then they're probably not dead. I mean, heck, look at the Hound. Everybody thought he was dead, and he sure as heck wouldn't, because he didn't show him actually dying.
Right. Good point.
So that's like you said, we'll talk about it a little bit later. So that was a super letdown for a lot of different fans. Like you said, it could very well be that wasn't the end of those two. We didn't actually see them die.
So nobody confirmed the kill yet. Brian, do you think Jaime and Cersei are dead? Real quick before we get back to Euron Greyjoy.
Yeah, I think they're dead.
Okay, Joe?
Yeah.
Joe, you think they're dead?
I think they're dead, and I will specifically say I believe they are dead, because if you're watching the streaming version, they have the inside with the directors at the end, and it seemingly seemed that they confirmed that Jaime and Cersei are no longer with us.
See, that's the thing. I mean, Daenerys might be like, I don't know if they're dead or not. I got to look for them. No, is anybody going to look for the bodies? You know, that's the thing. It's just, again, lazy writing. You know, this episode to me, guys, is kind of like, this is my least favorite episode. You know, I was worried about this. You know, I was worried about this, Joe, in the beginning of the season, before Game of Thrones started this season, that it was going to be too rushed. You know, and this episode, you know, it was going pretty good, you know, and all of a sudden this is like a roller coaster, man. Just went downhill. Fast. You know, I mean, 3 out of the 5 episodes, they farted around and barely did anything. You know, the first 2 episodes, barely anything. And no, we didn't go anywhere. You know, then we had this huge battle at Winterfell, and you know, the Night King was killed off quickly.
That is the part that, I mean, I'm still watching it, and I'm still watching it from a girlfriend, but for me, that was the part that almost ruined Game of Thrones entirely for me, is how they ended the White Walkers, the Night King.
Yeah. So, I mean, they weren't exactly, I mean, this only 6 episodes and ending, of course, the actors have been doing this for 10 years is understandable, but you know, they also complained about the ending too, so you know,
yeah,
you got one hand on the other, you know, you got one something one that fact in one hand and the other fact in the other. But for me, it's a little abrupt, and I thought, like, I think Brian was saying ahead of time that, you know, 8 episodes would have been,
yeah,
you know, would have really helped. Mm-hmm. Of course, if you watch, like Joe said, the inside, you know, each one of these episodes is like a full one movie production, you know, a Hollywood movie production, each episode. So,
and Tooch, let me chime in for a second.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys saw, but the week after the finale, HBO announced that they're going to be doing a documentary about the making of the final season. So that documentary will be coming out the week after the finale. So that could be another thing for us to talk about.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Do you think they're going to talk about the Starbucks cup? So, real quick off that,
I doubt
it. Did you see what happened in the last episode? When Jaime was down in the basement with Cersei, he hugged her, and it was his actual hand on her back instead of the metal hand that was supposed to be.
Oh, okay. Whoa. So
you'll have to look that up.
It's
something about like the hand that was supposed to be the metal hand. It's like on her back, and you could actually see like his fingers and fingernails as his actual hand, rather than the metal hand that it was supposed to be. I'll have to look that up real quick.
Right.
Someone fell asleep at the editing machine.
Again. Yeah. I know.
Yeah, again. Yeah, it's before the season, Joe and I, we did our pilot pilot episode where we talked about all the things that we'd like to see and what we thought would happen. And we were worried about 6 episodes only and, you know, worried about whether or talked about whether or not the show would go down as the greatest show in history. I got to say, this last season is kind of, you know, it's like it just didn't get over that high bar if it was if it was a high jump or a pole vault.
For sure.
We were pole vaulting.
Nope.
Mm-hmm. Because the first 4 seasons of Game of Thrones are absolutely brilliant. Kind of like the first 3 seasons of Lost, and then they piddled around for, you know, a couple more seasons after that, you know. And Game of Thrones, of course, after they ran out of source material.
Yeah, yeah.
And
how much did George Martin consult with the general way things are unfolding? Do you think he had some, you know, I mean, Dave and Dan, they probably said to George Martin, hey, can you give us a little, just a thumbnail sketch of what's going on in your mind?
Yeah, they had to have. I mean,
because they probably said, hey, we're pressed for time. You know, the network's probably saying you need to deliver these scripts before they get the green light to, you know, put the budget behind this season. Right. It's a shame, but that's the reality of filmmaking and production.
Well, Benioff and Weiss, you know, they claim to have gotten, you know, an outline from Martin. But who knows whether or not George Martin even knows how it's going to end. He's a writer who likes to have the characters take him on a journey, not the other way around. He has a rough outline, but things can change, characters can die, and such is the case with his writing style. But getting back to Euron Greyjoy, and we'll talk about Benioff and Weiss in the Streamer's Court, Joe, coming up on I Have a Stream. But Euron Greyjoy, the fight between Euron and Jaime was just kind of like, hey, these two characters, let's just have them fight to the death. You know, that'll be cool. But we got Clegane Bowl, so we didn't really need this Euron. But I would have been fine with Euron being torched on one of his ships, you know, and be done with him. But yeah, it was just kind of silly. The fight, you know, and unnecessary. Brian, what'd you think of the Euron Jaime fight?
They just wanted to get rid of Euron. They had to figure out how they were going to do it. You know, I wish it was like in some situation involving them and Cersei in the same room, you know, some interplay there. There could have been some great dialogue or, you know, an action, you know, I don't know. Yeah. It seemed a little rushed. I think they're like, yeah, we got to get on to Clegane Bowl.
Yeah.
And you know,
right.
Yeah. He was kind of a cartoony character all the way through for me.
Yeah, the book, you know, Euron is so much better.
The whole Greyjoy family dynamic is fleshed out a lot more in the books, and it's a lot more compelling.
Right. He's a pirate who demands silence on his ship so much so that he cuts the tongues of his men out.
And he has a horn that he got from old Valyria that supposedly can command dragons.
Yeah.
Under his command.
And they just couldn't fit all this stuff into the show. I mean...
And he was planning on sailing to Marine. That was the last we hear in Dance with Dragons. That's where he's heading. Yeah.
In the book, spoiler. So next character that dies is the kindly Maester Qyburn, which I love this actor. I can't remember the actor's name. He's great. He's very gentle but devious. And he was killed by his own creation, Joe. Did you think that was a fitting end for Kai? I kind of thought, I didn't have him die in a Deadpool. I thought he was one of those guys who could sneak off, you know, oily and slink off like Littlefinger. But, you know, neither of them escaped death. So, Qyburn's death. Thumbs up or down?
Yeah. You know, I thought it was fitting. I didn't see it coming the way it did. But, you know, I was really hoping he'd meet his end, especially by his own creation. So, that made me feel pretty good inside. I was very shocked with how gruesome and quickly he exploded into 1 million pieces, but man, oh man, that was quite the on-screen death.
Yeah. Let's talk about the Clegane Bowl, because we got it. It was good. That was probably one of the better scenes of this episode. Fan service notwithstanding, but It was beautifully shot, you know, like a crumbling stairway to the heights, you know, with the walls crumbling down, rubble flying everywhere, a dragon in the background, fire. It had everything, Aaron. What'd you think of Clegane Bowl? Satisfied or just fan service?
You know, I guess I'm satisfied. The Hound was actually one of my favorite characters. And the Mountain, the man who doesn't like the Mountain. It was a little bit, obviously, a little bit more one-sided. As a fan of the Hound, I would have liked a little bit more from him. Actually, you know, instead of just the Mountain being a tower of mean meat that just can take whatever you throw at him, it would have been great if the Hound got a couple of in, because you want him to get something like that, since, you know, what happened to his face and his brother's been kind of a jerk to him. But, I mean, ultimately, like you said, beautifully shot. When the walls crumbling, the sun's coming in from behind him, you know, and then you got... Sir Gregor standing there, and then he tackles him through. I thought that was actually probably one of the highlights of the whole episode for me, especially.
Yeah, it was a great battle. Brian, what do you think? I mean, I love Rory McCann's portrayal of the Hound.
Yeah,
I loved,
one of the best.
I loved Arya and Hound's last moments together. Take us through that. Were you satisfied with the ending for the Hound?
I was. I mean, I was... You know, one of my favorite characters, you know, like you said, his whole journey throughout the entire run of the show has been one of the best payoffs, I think, in that regard, you know, especially Arya kind of looking up to him after hating him and traveling with him and knowing him, mm-hmm. and then becoming like him. And he says, this is what you become if you follow me. And she came back to being Arya Stark of Winterfell. And she thanked him and called him Sandor, and that was real. That was touching. And you know, he went out and he said, you know, you have a life you can go live. You know, get out. And boy, oh boy, did it! Yeah, it went out. That was perfectly shot. That was the best part of the show. That episode, you know.
Yeah, Joe, you're a big Star Wars fan. The Mountain, when his helmet was removed, did that remind you of anything?
Yes.
Yeah, it's definitely a Darth Vader nod there.
Yeah.
And another family member remembering that he's his brother, clearly, because he wouldn't listen to Cersei or anybody for that matter.
Yeah.
And the guy was Nikki in the chat room says the Force is strong with me. So thank you very much, sir. but yeah, very crazy how, you know, nothing the Hound did to this dude would even faze him.
Yeah.
Stabs him through the chest, mm-hmm. through the eye, through the ear, through the neck. This dude just keeps going, and at one point you just kind of see it click, and he's like, you know, I got to take this guy down with me. And how fitting for the Hound to die by fire.
Yeah,
I didn't think about that.
He had to make a tackle. Huh? Bears Barroom tackle.
Khalil Mack would be proud.
Bears tackle.
Right. And speaking of football, we got the most satisfying death of the entire show. That was Aaron Rodgers dying, whose cameo.
Yeah, how about that?
Burned alive, which for Bears fans everywhere was... you know, very satisfying.
The only thing would have been better if he was eaten by that undead bear north of the wall.
That would have been a little more beautiful. Fitting, right?
Beautiful.
Right. So the next big death we got was the Golden Company, the feared Golden Company, and they were put to bed pretty early. Why the hell were they outside the walls, man? I don't get it. You got the king, walls of King's Landing, you know, to protect you. Let the Northmen, Dothraki and Unsullied, you know, try and storm the walls. But, you know, it didn't matter. Drogon snuck in behind, blew the gates open, and, you know, we found out the reason why they couldn't spend any money on Direwolf CGI, Joe, because a lot of the CGI went to the destruction of King's Landing, which... Looked great. Not sure. I mean, it was disappointing, and we'll talk about that.
I want to know the kind. I want to know the kind of fire that can destroy bricks.
The nuclear weapon dragon fire. So, we'll talk about that as we get into our thoughts for the final episode. But
an exploding wildfire all over the place too.
Yeah, I noticed that too.
Which, stored there from the Mad King's day.
Right, exactly. That's my theory as well. It was left over from King Aerys, Daenerys' father, who it was rumored, I think this goes back to when Qyburn was telling Cersei if the rumors were true about wildfire everywhere. So, and he assured her that there was plenty of wildfire left, and she used it to blow up the Tyrells and the High Sparrow. But let's talk about of course, the Iron Fleet was another one we lost, which will allow Yara to take control of the seas maybe in next episode. But Cersei and Jaime's death, Cersei's death especially, that was too good of a death for her. Aaron, what do you think? She got the easy way out?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, for somebody that everybody I talked to absolutely hated her. I mean, the same thing as Joffrey. Everybody's like, I cannot wait till she dies. And we waited how many seasons, years? And then she got to be in the arms of somebody she loved. If she died, again, we'll go back to that.
Right.
But it's just, it seemed like I was waiting for somebody else to kill her. There were so many different foreshadowings and things people, at least they thought they saw in the past. Like, there was a scene where she's standing on the map with Jaime, and I forget me for not remember, but she's standing on something called the throat, and he's standing on something called the hand, according to the map. So
the neck
everybody
and the fingers.
Very cool. So I mean, everybody thought he was going to be the one that ended up killing her, but I think she got off way too easy. I think for me,
right? And we'll talk about Jaime in a second because, Joe, Cersei's death, I know she got to slip by, you know, when she saw the Clegane brothers about to have their throwdown, she slipped by, and I kind of had a feeling at that moment that Cersei was going to get off easy and we weren't going to get a good death. What do you think? Were we ripped off as viewers who wanted to see Cersei, or has she suffered enough in this show that she earned an easy death?
Well, I think that's an open-ended question, Tooch. I think that's a tough question to ask because, I, for one, really wanted to see Cersei get it, right? And something about this episode made me sympathize with her, and I'm not sure why.
Sure.
And I really found myself sympathizing for her.
Yeah.
And, I felt it was a little bit ironic, but at the same time, I was really hoping that Jaime would strangle her to death. So, and then they'd both die side by side. But actually, Nikki in the chat room just said he's surprised a lot of people don't understand the irony behind her death. She was killed by her own tower, which is kind of a little ironic as well.
Yeah, that's a good point. She did kind of at the end, I want to live, I want to live for my baby or our baby, and it ended up kind of being an affirmation of ancestral love to me. I mean, I'm not sure that that's what they were going for, but, the love story of Jaime and Cersei, that's what we got. We got the lover's embrace at the end, Brian. How did you feel about how Jaime and Cersei went out? Cause I mean, I was kind of like,
That was just a perfect example of how this season has been rushed. They could have played it out better. I mean, Jaime, I figured he'd go to the final episode. I really did. And Cersei, I had a feeling she might go out, but maybe they're kind of setting this up where, she got killed by the, getting crushed. So it kind of cheats Daenerys out of confronting her and putting her, executing her. And so also I was thinking when Qyburn came up and said, we have to leave now, I thought maybe it was going to be Arya in his skin. Mm. And then they would have had the Clegane Bowl starting off there, the Hound would be there with her. She would be, dressed as Qyburn, would kill Cersei.
Oh,
right. Well, we'll talk about Arya when we get to our predictions for episode 6. But yeah, it's a great point. Yeah, for me, rushed, you know, rushed. You know how I feel. Joe, let's enter the streamer's court with Judge Tooch.
This is the streamer's court with Judge Tooch.
This is Judge Tooch, and our defendants are Benioff and Weiss. Are they guilty or not guilty? Our plaintiffs are, besides the subscribers to HBO, Joey Two Scoops.
Hello.
Aaron Michalski.
Yes, sir.
And Brian Shanahan. Those three. Hello. Will be a jury of three.
Oh, no.
That was me. My bad.
Benioff and Weiss are on trial. The ending for Cersei and Jaime. Guilty or not guilty of bad writing, Joe?
Oh, man. That's tough. I get that they were probably going for some sort of ironic twist with the arms around her neck and a hug as opposed to being choked out, but everyone just wanted to see her get choked out, so I'm going to say it was bad writing.
Juror Shanahan.
I say guilty of unintentionally quickened writing. It was the nicest thing to say that it was bad that the way they ended it out. So yeah, guilty of bad writing.
Judge or Juror Michalski.
You know, just it's tough separating your emotions from the actual decision. Especially when you're on the juror. So I don't think it was bad writing. If I did, it's strictly because it didn't end like I'd like it to. But I think, I mean, for me, I'm going to have to say no, it's not bad writing. For that character, it was an okay end. It didn't end like I wanted it to. I don't know anybody that ended like they did. But I wouldn't say bad writing, though.
The evidence
here. Yeah,
maybe
here not bad writing, but just, you know, sped right. up.
No, yeah, out of their for sure.
I don't think they had a choice. They had to end it.
How about
I don't think they wanted to.
Extremely careless.
I could vote guilty on extremely careless.
Jamie's end. Now, he was on a redemption arc, then decided to say, fuck it, I'm going back. You know, and I only love my sister. Is that the ending George Martin's going to go for, Juror Mandel? You think in the books.
Oh, jeez. Just when I think I know what George R. R. Martin's going to do, I think he... I feel like he puts every idea he has in his head into, like, a game of Boggle. Like, he kind of puts it inside the jar and he shakes it around. And then he pulls out an idea and he kind of puts all the different ideas together. So, I don't have the slightest clue, man. But I tell you what, it's going to be nothing like the show.
Juror Shanahan.
Yes, sir.
Bungling the redemption arc of Jaime Lannister. Are Benioff and Weiss guilty or not guilty?
I think they're guilty because there was so much invested in him. And we really come to like him as a character actor, especially when all the fantastic moments that he had with Brienne. That was one of the best one-on-one. I mean, yeah. Nikolai Coster-Waldau is a great actor, and he had great chemistry with Brienne and with Tyrion, you know, great, and with, you know, Lena Headey. I mean, he's just a great actor, and he's great on one-on-one, even going back to season two with Catelyn Stark, you know, just great right. one-on-one dialogue, and we wanted something more epic for him. We all did, but we don't know what it was, but I feel a little sad that he's just kind of gone quick.
Yeah, the hero's ending was kind of what we wanted for Jaime. He kind of got a rogue's ending. Juror Michalski, Jaime Lannister going back to the sister is the only woman he loves, an affirmation of incestual love. Not sure that's what George Martin would want for the character of Jaime Lannister. I don't know yet because we haven't read the books. Are Benioff and Weiss guilty of bungling the redemption arc of Jaime Lannister?
Oh, yeah. And, yep, 100%. Yeah, no, absolutely guilty. I think, like everybody else has said, everything that he had done to become the character that we absolutely despise, this pretty boy jerk that was, you know, all about money and glory, to actually having some character and showing a lot of heart for people, to throw that away, not do the right thing and go back to his sister was, I think, like everything else you've discussed, it was rushed to me. It definitely felt like it was really rushed. They didn't know what to do, so they're like, here, we're going to put you here, and they're going to go here, and that's it for you. So that's guilty.
Now, go to Tyrion Lannister. His final past, recent past, he's made a lot of bad decisions, you know? And I know that Peter Dinklage just talked about this, about how he would never be down in a crypt where dead bodies are when the Night King is resurrecting dead bodies, is what Peter Dinklage said. He was disappointed in how his character ended. We still don't know how Tyrion ends because he is still alive at this moment. But his decision to rat out Varys, not usually, you know, that's usually not what Tyrion does. He usually make mistakes like that. Guilty of bungling Tyrion Lannister, Juror Mandel. Wasting Tyrion's intellect.
You know, I don't think, I think it's too early to say, really. Personally, I think that the last episode is going to have a lot to do with how I feel about the handling of Tyrion. I will say that scene he had where he let his brother escape, let Jaime escape, similar to how Jaime let him escape from his own father's clutches, I thought that was really well done and beautiful. And at that point, I knew Jaime was dying. It was pretty obvious. And I kind of thought they were both going to die in that episode. But
wasn't Jaime supposed to sail to Pentos with Cersei in a boat that had no sail?
Yeah, it sounded really optimistic and impossible,
that sounds
right?
Like a song.
I've sailed to Pentos with a boat with no sail. that was the plan. Tyrion was like, you can catch the winds to Pentos, but Ser Davos didn't know that was the plan because he didn't include a sail with the boat. But
there's only one bit of wind that was caught in this episode.
Drogon farts.
Juror Shanahan guilty of bungling Tyrion's intellect, Benioff and Weiss. Guilty or not guilty?
No, not guilty, because I'll reserve that till the last episode's done.
Okay, all right.
However, I will say, ever since Tyrion killed Shay and killed his father, and then he was on a suicide, pretty much just drinking himself to death, you know, with when Varys and him headed out to see Daenerys. I just feel like once he got to Daenerys, like the last good mistake he made that fell into luck was that he, you know, he introduced himself to Daenerys. And then ever since then, it's just his intellect. He's been in doubt of himself. He hasn't been himself. He's not himself. And, you know, his betrayal of his family. I think that just all those things that made him super clever in the beginning of the show, they just kind of let it deteriorate. Like he's not all there. That's all cracked up to be and what he thinks he is. So it's, right. We'll see. You know,
he may be in trouble for letting his brother go. We still don't know. We may see that in episode 6. Aaron, Tyrion's final days here, his bad decisions, bungled by Benioff or Weiss, guilty or not guilty?
That's a tough one. Because even leading up to this one, there'd been a few different times that he'd let Dany down with his advice.
Mm-hmm.
So, but then, knowing who he is and he's an intellectual, do you think maybe he was trying to steer her a different way? It's a theory. That's a tough one for me.
Yeah, he underestimated his sister.
Yeah.
A few bad decisions,
he overestimated Jaime. So, I mean, having that said, then yeah, I think they bungled him. I don't think they've done that character justice because he's been so great, like Ryan said, throughout. And then just it seems like recently he hadn't had that touch, that hyper-intellectual touch that seemed to make him kind of stand out like Varys or Littlefinger, right. Just a really smart person that people counted on. So,
right. Now, the last... Go ahead, Joe.
Real quick, Tooch. Yeah. I do think he tried a very diplomatic solution there, and Danny agreed to him that he would agree if they ring the bells that it would be a surrender.
Yeah.
And I mean, he did everything very monarch-like.
Sure.
And he did everything to avoid the catastrophe that actually happened. Right. And Danny kind of stabbed Tyrion in the back in this one. So I go ahead and argue the other way. I think he set everything up perfectly so that it would have been, you know, a picture-perfect happy surrender, if you will. And we didn't get that because Danny lost her shit.
That's the final...
said she'd break the wheel.
Right, the final piece here for the final bit of evidence. Daenerys's turning from good, we think, to Mad Queen. Bungled by Benioff or Weiss or not? Let's start with Brian. What do you think, Brian? Did you buy Danny's sudden snap? Is that the way people snap? Do they go crazy all of a sudden? Was it building for a long time? Was it handled well or was it rushed? Bungled by Benioff or Weiss? Guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty, because I'm just taking it for how everything's moving this season. I mean, we obviously saw her isolation throughout this season so far, you know, cutting away. Now she loses Ser Jorah. She loses Missandei. Now she loses Jon. She has nothing except to install fear in everyone. And she just lost it. And like Varys said at the beginning of that episode, every time you toss a coin when Targaryen is born, you don't know what you're going to get. And he was kind of telling Jon, like, you're the good coin toss. And she's not. And we saw it. Oh, boy. That was shocking. We rooted for her for so long, and now she's full-on evil.
Yeah, and I'm not sure I'd buy it, but you're the jurors. I'm just the judge. Juror Mandel. Danny going Anakin Skywalker. Are you buying how it was handled by Benioff and Weiss? Bungled or not bungled? Guilty or not guilty?
You know, I'm going to be in the minority. I think that they are not guilty because just watch every single episode where she deals with her enemies. And in the very early seasons when she has her brother melted to death by really hot gold or whatever it is, she was cold as ice, right? No emotion. She crucified all the slave owners. She did all these terrible things and didn't bat an eye.
Roasted all the cows.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. She she crucified all of the slavers.
Yeah. So it's in her MO, and I think it was a slow build up, and I think they did it justice. I think people that are saying that it was rushed aren't really looking at the full story,
right?
If you will, I feel like it's all there. I feel like, you know, she had a decision in front of her, and she had all this pain that caused her to go on this journey in the first place. So people forget about that, and if you were in the same situation, how would you react? If they did all those terrible things to my family and, you know, put me in exile and all that, and if I had a second to think about it, if you caught me on the wrong day and a lot of terrible things happened, which they have happened to her recently, losing all her friends, you know, I have a hard time saying that I wouldn't do exactly the same thing.
Right. Now, she did hear the bells, correct, Aaron?
Yeah, no, she definitely did, and I'm actually going to counter Joe on this one. And in almost in most situations, when she did, you know, exact her wrath, I can think of a few of them where she gave them an option to more or less, you know, she gave the slavers a chance, gave up the slaves, leave the city. They didn't leave the city.
The Tarleys.
With Sam's, with the Tarleys, she said, you guys can do that, or you could leave.
Bend the knee.
Bend the knee, or you can, well, not leave necessarily, get incinerated, but there's, I mean, on almost, and I'm having trouble thinking of every situation, but more often than not, she's been fair and given a choice. So it's not like you just pissed her off and she torched you. She's had more, she's given people opportunity to bend the knee, but this time it was something different where, I mean, to answer the question for me, I do think they bungled it because she had been given all the choices, and it was just such a quick turn when I didn't feel like, she had something. So like Grey Worm, right? Lost Missandei. So you kind of saw that when he started fighting them. But for her, everything that's terrible has happened, but at least there wasn't enough for me in recent history for her to really validate her going nuts like that. especially considering her fair point in the past.
How about John?
Yeah, Benny. How about Weiss? So far, guilty on some stuff, not guilty on some others. We'd probably have a hung jury. We'll have to wait and do Streamer's Court next week when we recap the entire series. But
real quick, Tooch, I think Brian had something he wanted to say.
Just one thing. What Aaron was saying there made me think of that shot when she had Masande's only personal possession. It was her slave collar. And she handed it over to Grey Worm. And what Aaron was saying there is, like, maybe the choice is, then she mentioned something about, well, they revolted against the slavers. And Tyrion said, well, they're not going to uprise. They're hostages. And when she said that, you know, I mean, I think, yeah, that seemed like, oh, boy, Tyrion kind of knew, like, it's 50-50. It's
Grey Worm, Grey Worm tossed that slave collar right into the fire. You know, poor Missandei didn't own many possessions, not even her own.
Well, I tell you what,
clothes.
I tell you what, Grey Worm had the same sentiment as Missandei. That's his way of saying, burn them all.
Yeah, well. Now the bloodlust evident in Grey Worm and Daenerys. Daenerys really kind of a spoiled kid with a nuclear weapon. You know,
more or less.
That's what we're supposed to believe. Not sure I buy it yet. I'll have to wait and reserve judgment. Now, here's the thing. Daenerys felt, you know, after defeating the army of the dead, like an outsider. No one was on her side. Nobody really grateful to her face. That had to have something to do with maybe her snapping and her uttering the words, "Let it be fear," then, to Jon Snow. Now, does Jon Snow share any of the blame in this? Unable to return affections of Dany. Why do you guys think, I'll start with Joe, why do you think Dany or Jon can't return Dany's affection?
Well, I think he is being, you know, he's getting all that grief from his family, and he's starting to think about the fact that, you know what, I'm pledging my allegiance to a woman that I'm valuing over my family right now, and Arya and Sansa are kind of stressing that home with him, and I think all the doubt that's seeping around him is having an effect on him, and I think he kind of wants to see how things play out, and I don't blame him one bit, but I do think some of the blame lies on him because he followed her so blindly, if you will. I know he needed her to destroy the White Walkers, which he did what was necessary, but at the same time, you know, when that was all said and done, you know, maybe you do make your play for the crown there and you save a lot of lives afterwards.
Now, I mean, as soon as Jon found out that Daenerys was his aunt, you know, kind of threw cold water on their relationship, Aaron. Why do you think, what do you think the real reason is for a combination of things, maybe? Or why do you think Jon hasn't been able to return any of Dany's affections? I mean, he was fine before, you know. I think there might have been a shot at love and giving us a happy ending, which is what all viewers wanted, is a happy ending for Jon and Dany. Why do you think that is?
You know, I think, well, number one, hopefully it's because he found out they're related. But a lot of times, too, when you think about the past with Jon, he never really thought he was worth much because he was a Snow. He was a bastard. He was talked down to his entire life. He just, as far as he was concerned, he didn't
matter. That's a great point.
But now he finds out, oh, not only am I somebody, but I am officially the somebody. I am literally the next person in line for the throne. So I think he's had this kind of quiet confidence about himself. He knew what he was worth, but then finding out that he's actually a Targaryen must have been super validating for him. I think that may have been a boost for him to maybe even secretly he's thought about the throne. But not only has he thought about taking it, but now he actually has a right and a claim to it.
It really is a great point, but I'm not sure he's really done processing this fact about who he really is, whether or not he can follow the Targaryen way of marrying relatives to relatives. Brian, what do you think Jon's deal is?
Yeah, he's torn. It's obviously come to the final head. You know, he pledged his allegiance to her, and she let him down.
He's a man of his word.
And now he knows that he's always trying to do the right thing, and he knows that the right thing is to go against her now, because I don't know what her attitude is towards him right now.
Sure.
Because, Or to Sansa. You know, I mean, how is her next target going to be Sansa? You know, I mean,
why? Like, I mean,
Jon's torn, but he's going to always bound to do the right thing, even when it cost him his life.
Here's the thing: when people found out who Jon's real identity were, the advisors of Daenerys, which I believe were not
Tyrion.
Yeah, when they found out about it, why didn't they suggest, as Ser Davos did, a marriage? Nobody ever brought it up to these two. You know, nobody tried to broker any kind of, you know, marriage pact for these two. And I think this is a big failing of the writing. I think the fact that they lost an opportunity to say, hey, Targaryens, wed Targaryens, you two love each other, you know? Instead, it was kind of forgotten. Ser Davos didn't step forward, certainly, and say, you two should get married and rule together as king and queen, something the Seven Kingdoms has never had before, you know? Instead, what we got was fire and blood.
Yeah, but which one makes for better TV?
Yeah, I guess. Because the viewer's so accustomed to, you know, the princes and princesses having happy endings, and you know, this ain't no fairy tale.
No.
So, let's talk about our thoughts, maybe, for the last episode. I want to talk about Bran. Are we even going to see Bran again? I'll go around, start with Joe. Where was Bran? And we'll talk about Arya, too, and, of course, the White Horse. We'll get to the White Horse. Play the damn Taylor Swift song. Might as well talk about the White Horse. But let's talk about Bran. Is he done for this series? Do you think we'll see him again? Joe, what do you think?
He's not done for the series, because if he is, I'm going to be pissed because he didn't do jack shit. there's got to be some bigger play here at the end, so... all I can imagine is perhaps there's a big to-do that at the end, where maybe he wargs into a dragon and eats Danny or something like that. So if he doesn't warg in the last episode, I'm going to be pretty upset. And he has been the most useless character by far this season.
Yeah, I mean, the way to stop the dragon is maybe to become the dragon, Joe. I like it. Brian, what do you think about Bran? What's he going to do? Is he coming out in episode 6, or is the story ended?
I agree with Joe. There's got to be some payoff with Bran. I mean, I'm curious to see if the final episode starts with him seeing what happened down at King's Landing and just, you know, letting everybody up there know, because he might know something about her coming to get to Winterfell. So I mean, you know, that's all gonna play in, is that now it's the pretty much the Lannisters are wiped out except Tyrion,
right?
It's a Stark Targaryen thing right now. It's the ice and fire. It's gotta play out something big with Bran. Maybe he sent that horse to Arya, you know. Maybe there's something he has a hand at what's gonna happen next down at King's Landing.
Right, a lot of people think, that he's.
Or maybe things end on Dragonstone, because she was born on Dragonstone. Maybe it'll end on Dragonstone for her.
Right. Aaron, what do you think? Bran have a part to play in this last episode?
You know, to me, Bran, ever since he became the cripple, and the whole work thing had to do with the Night King and the White Walkers, and they ended that. So, that's everything, from what I can remember, had to do with the White Walkers and the Night King. Everything with him was connected to them, and obviously he has been a non-factor since they ended that on the Battle of Winterfell. So, to me, it would not surprise me if we didn't see him again.
Right, okay. So Arya rides off on a white horse. Maybe Bran sent the horse. Is Arya going to be the one to kill Dany again? She saved the day against the Night King. Joe? What do you think? Is Arya to the rescue again?
I really think she is. I think she's coming to the rescue. And I have to talk a little bit about something that I mentioned to you on Twitter after the episode. And that's a biblical verse.
Right.
That I think this is definitely got to be a playoff of. And it's from Revelation 6:7-8. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse.
Yep.
And his name that sat on him was Death, and Hell followed with him. So I think, you know, Arya's got to be out for vengeance, and she's on the way to spread death upon that that Targaryen army. And it's worth asking, is Arya Azor Ahai?
Yeah, I'm not sure. It's a great question. Don't know if the... we don't have Melisandre around to tell us whether she is or not. So maybe some priestesses from Ahai come in the last episode. I doubt it. We thought we might see Daario Naharis. If I was Danny, I'd probably send for him right now with his second sons to make sure I lock up the Iron Throne for good. But I don't think we'll see that. I would have liked to have seen Jaqen H'ghar end up being Jon's real father. With one episode left, we probably won't see that. But I have a question about Jon Snow. Jon Snow could be the one to take out Dany. Did Dany try to eliminate Jon by destroying King's Landing, knowing that he was in the city of King's Landing? Brian, what do you think?
I don't know. I think she was strafing, like zigzagging. So I mean, John. I mean, in the horde of Unsullied, I don't know. She might have not have been hitting anywhere that might have hurt the Unsullied. So I don't think she was necessarily like firing too close to her troops.
Sure.
But then again, she might have just went nuts and didn't care who she burnt.
John instantly, with Cersei gone, John becomes the biggest threat to the Iron Throne for Dany. Aaron, do you think Dany still loves John, or is she going to take him out? She loves John or Dracarys?
That last question, it's funny because I actually misunderstood it, and I understood the last question as, do you think she destroyed everything so John couldn't have it because she knows he's got the rightful claim?
No, I thought she was trying to kill him, eliminate him.
Yep, I see. I misunderstood the last question, but until Brian answered it,
he is the biggest threat, you know.
No, for sure. So the way that I took it, at least in my head, was I was like, oh, she's trying to burn up the city so he can't sit on the throne because there is no throne, there's no city, so she's trying to take all that away from him. You know, with how quick her character turned, it wouldn't surprise me if she tries to kill John. It really wouldn't.
Joe, what do you think? Dany still loves John, maybe wants to marry him, unite the North and the South, or Dracarys for John?
I think it's all about the Dracarys, and you saw that look on Jon Snow's face when the soldiers started going for that free-for-all. Like, he looked at the camera, and you saw that look, and this is all I could think of.
I have a bad feeling about this.
He wasn't just upset that Aaron Rodgers was burned up, I'm guessing. He was
well, I mean, I could go for some Saganaki, if you know what I mean.
Oh, my favorite, man. Love it. I'm kind of the mind we're going to get a scene where, you know, Dany, you know, still loves John, but John tries to kill her, or vice versa, you know. One or the other is going to try to kill the other, you know. Not sure that... I'm pretty sure we aren't getting a happy ending in this one. One of those... Any chance of a John and Mary... Dany marriage? What do you think, Brian?
That could happen if this final episode, she pretty much has Unsullied drag John to her and demands that he marries her. And, you know, I mean, you know, just like kind of forces him, like, you have one choice, you know, marry me or die. And John, being the noble guy he is, he'll be compelled to protect whatever's left of the realm, his family in Winterfell, you know. Like, she'll threaten Winterfell if he doesn't marry her. That could happen.
Right. What do you think, Joe? Marriage still in the cards? If Ser Davos and Tyrion maybe get involved, or... too late. Nobody wants, psycho bitch for a wife.
Nobody wants psycho bitch for a wife. And let's be honest. No one's going to survive very long. Not much. There's only an hour and 20 minutes left in the show. So there's no weddings. There's no time for a wedding. Let's be honest.
Okay, so Aaron, no wedding, I'm guessing, for you. No
Nah, I mean, that's, I'm not going to say it's not going to be a happy ending. Something, you know, if John gets it, it could totally be a happy ending, depending on how you feel about it. But I don't see, especially with how hard her character twists in the last one, I don't see her coming to her senses all of a sudden and coming up with a reasonable conclusion.
Right. Now, Sansa, you know, never liked Dany. We're not sure why. I mean, now that, of course, Dany has, you know, given Sansa, I was right, you know, the chick was crazy. But, I mean, Dany felt like she had no friends and Sansa didn't really treat her as an ally. So there's that. You know, I'm sure she felt like she had no allies and had to destroy everything, you know, and she wasn't just taking Drogon out for a test ride to see what this baby could do. But, any last predictions for episode 6 before we end the show? Let's start with Brian. What do you think? Who ends up on the? I hate to put you guys on the spot like this, because
I'm really excited. I got
really just a guess. All right, we'll start with Aaron. I'll start with Aaron. What do you think? Any predictions? Who ends up on the Iron Throne? Happy ending? Sad ending?
Tyrion. I think, what if he ends up on the throne? That's what I'm kind of hoping for. I can see it going that way. I mean, Danny's gone nutsy Fagin. John doesn't seem like he's overly excited about it. And out of all the characters out there, who better than Tyrion to take it?
Yeah, he doesn't want the throne, Jon Snow, so let someone else take it. I don't want it. Joe?
Tyrion would be good.
Joe, what do you think? Predictions for the last episode.
Yeah, I think it's going to come out that Tyrion is a Targaryen. He is one of the three-headed monster. And I believe he will be sentenced to death, possibly by fire. Mm-hmm. And he will not be burned by the flames.
Wow, great. Love it.
So he will emerge as a Targaryen, and Dany won't know what to do with herself. Then perhaps Jon sacrifices himself, takes out Dany. Jon also dies. And then you have Tyrion sitting on the throne, drinking a lot of wine.
And knowing.
And banging a lot of hoes.
Right. I like it. Brian, what do you think?
That sounds extremely plausible. That he would rule Westeros with Sansa, maybe. You know, there would be
that union
if he was the Targaryen Stark union.
Right.
You know, if it isn't Tyrion, and I mean, I don't know if any of you feel it could be Jon. I don't know. I think maybe Jon and Dany both go out, you know, and maybe Arya. Arya could, but Tyrion seems the most plausible right now. But I was going to ask you guys, do you think there'll be any bits at the end that'll be like a flash forward 20 years or, you know, any of that kind of, you know, finale kind of thing where they would show kind of the aftermath, you know, number of decades after, you know, like how the world kind of responded to whatever, you know, finally goes down. Do you think they would do that? I mean,
I really would have liked to have seen something like that. Of course, I thought Dany might have been pregnant by John. We'd get like maybe a child. I mean, that could still happen. I'm sure trending the other way, though. But it sure is trending towards no happy ending, for sure. Dany, we went from one... I mean, if you're... We've loved the show for the female characters, you know, and what we got was two mad queens. Kind of, you know, like, you know, the mad queens couldn't handle the role. Let's get another man in there. Kind of like how we haven't had a woman president yet.
But, here come the emails.
I'm sure that's not the answer they were. I mean, that's not the what they were going for. You know, I mean, because I would have really have liked to seen, you know, Dany and John rule together, we still could get that, but it's trending the other way. But you know, two mad queens, it doesn't doesn't spell, you know, happiness. It's just bad.
Unless it's a drag club.
Ooh, nice.
I We still could get, a pregnancy. Probably not. We still could get your flash forward. Don't know. Sansa and Tyrion sure could probably end up together. That's a possibility. I'm sure that Sansa is probably turned off of sex forever after being married to Ramsay Bolton and Joffrey and Tyrion. So Tyrion could continue his whoring ways, and their marriage could continue being platonic. But Tyrion could still be a Targaryen. Don't know. They've left not enough time to give us all these great endings, and I'm sure that the ending. My prediction is that the ending will not live up to what we expect. I expect a little bit of a letdown. If Arya takes out Dany, it's going to be Arya to the rescue, twice, the Deus Ex Arya.
I can't believe that in the Night King like that, man.
Yeah, I thought it was kind of cool and stuff, but, the Night King never really was that big of a threat as he was billed, we got that great episode Beyond the Wall, then we just got a quick death and, a slow march towards Bran to be
broke my heart.
Super villain slow march towards the execution and not coming through. But we've reached the end of the show. Joe, can you take us out with? Oh, wait. Let's thank our guests. Aaron.
Let's do it.
Aaron Michalski. Where can we find Aaron on Twitter?
I am at A Michalski 88. That's AMICHALSKI 88. That's where you can find me at.
Great. And Brian, thanks for coming on, being the voice.
Thank you, guys.
Of Krusty, and for hanging out with us to talk Game of Thrones.
Hey!
You'll see Brian again on Bears Barroom for sure. Joe Mandel, where can we find you on Twitter?
Well, you just said it. It's real easy. It's at Joe Mandel.
Right. And, follow the show. I have a stream at I Have a Stream Pod. Follow me at Santucci _ John. I want to thank Barilissimo for his commercial, a word from our sponsor. I want to thank the great Dan Aguirre, the voice of Bears Barroom, who put together all the intros, the golden pipes that you heard in Brian's intro, you heard in the Streamers Court. Thanks again for Dan Aguirre, super fan Dan. All right. Joe, take us out with some television. Thanks, all the barflies. Good night.
And a quick thank you to John Santucci, the Tooch, for running this show. Man. And this is what I like to call him.
We know each other. He's a friend from work. Where have you been? Everybody thought you were dead.
I see those.